Hi, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, your host on Inspire Nation. If you've ever struggled, had self-doubt, felt trapped, at a dead end, or like your life wasn't igniting, then do we have the show for you. Today, I'll be talking with John O'Leary, one of my all-time favorite heroes, both him and his mom, though I just heard about him a few weeks ago. He's the author of a future New York Times bestseller, On Fire, The Seven Choices to Ignite a Radically Inspired Life, and one of the most inspirational people I have ever had the pleasure to have on the show. Today we'll talk about John's miraculous journey, one that should have killed him, and instead helped mold him into the person he is today. We'll talk about going through our own fires in life, flipping the ignition, learning to burn, and out of the fire, creating something more beautiful than we could have ever imagined. That plus we'll talk about the world's greatest mom, accumulating baseballs, Fra Puta Maha Suan Pati Makan, and what in the world?
That was not easy.
That means, and why in the world you'd want someone to get in a hockey brawl for you. So welcome to the show, John. Are you ready to shine?
Brother Michael Sandler, I am shining and ready to shine, man. Thank you.
Well, woohoo! And thank you so much, Brother John, for being on the show. So before we dive right into things, I've got to ask, do you still love potatoes au gratin?
You know, let me answer that by saying it differently. I get interviewed an awful lot. The book came out March 15th. We've been interviewed hundreds of times. And frequently, they are layup questions. So for you to begin already in a place that was buried within the book on potatoes au gratin, to know that you've read the story, to know that you care about the story, and ultimately, Michael, to know that you live the story means much more to me than I can even share right now. So, brother, I appreciate it. And yes, I still do love cheesy goodness.
Woohoo! and then the follow-up question to that is, what in the world is a milkshake promise?
Yeah, so... You know, when I was 9 years old, I was in a fire, and we'll talk a little bit about that. But when I asked my mother, when she came into the emergency room the first time, she'd not seen me since the event. She'd not seen what I looked like. She walked in, took my hand in hers, and she said, "I love you." And my response back to her, Michael, was, "Mom, enough of the love, enough of it. Am I going to die?" And what I was really looking for was not truth. It was the milkshake promise. It's the kid's promise that we all receive when we're in the emergency room or we're about to get a shot, where the parent will say to the child, "Everything's okay. When you get out of here in a few minutes, I'm going to take you by the drive-thru. We'll get you a milkshake on the way home." So I call that the milkshake promise. It's providing hope, but maybe not layered with truth to those we serve. And I think we do it for kids, but I also think we do it in partnerships and marriages and at work and in life. And it's something that sometimes we're better off not providing. No more milkshake promises.
All right. So let's back up and let's get in a time machine. Let's go back into that day if we could, or maybe we even go back to that week to start. What did you see the other kids in the neighborhood doing?
Yeah. So I'm a St. Louis, Missouri kid. I'm growing up in the Midwest. 9 years old, I've seen some little guys in my neighborhood playing with fire and gasoline. This is typical male behavior for your female listeners. I mean, but this is something many little boys will experiment with.
I almost blew up our house, and I had flames reaching to the ceiling, and I'm going, "Oh crap, this is it." So,
dude, every little boy right now is nodding their head saying, "I am guilty too," and every little girl is thinking, "What is wrong with these boys?" So I'm learning from their behavior, and I assumed if they could do it, so could I. So on a Saturday morning with my mom and dad gone, I went into the garage, lit a piece of cardboard on fire, came over to a can of gasoline, and Michael, the plan was to pour just a tiny bit of gasoline on top of a burning piece of paper. Before the liquid comes out, the fumes come out of that can. It creates this massive explosion, splits the can in two, picks up the 9-year-old little boy, launches him 20 feet against the far side of the garage, sets me on fire, sets my world on fire, and forever changes my life.
What's fascinating, forgive me for saying this, but what's fascinating about this is you light up when telling this story as if it was the greatest gift in your life.
Yeah. And so first of all, thanks for acknowledging that. And secondly, I think you're speaking truth, because it is. And I would never have said that day I was burned, or the 5 months in recovery, or the years of surgery and therapy that followed. But looking back on it, Michael, I'm sitting talking to you as a world traveler who gets to go around the entire world sharing this wild story. I'm a best-selling author today, which I would have never been able to do, I don't think, without this incredible story that has reminded me what really matters in life. I ultimately grew in faith, and courage, audacity, character because of a fire. I leaned into my family in ways that I never would have otherwise. I went to a school that I would have not gone to otherwise, which led to a chance encounter with a brunette with brown eyes and the prettiest face of an eagle I've ever seen. Woohoo is right. And four children and an amazing, charmed life because of this horrible, tragic incident. So excuse me if I'm smiling when I talk about it, but man, I realized today, wow, what a gift, what a blessing. And today I finally can count it as one.
So then going back to that day, how'd you end up getting to the hospital?
I think before I say, well, an ambulance drove me, I think the real question is, how'd you even get put out, man? I mean, it sounds like you're nine and you're trapped in a garage, and I was. Flames were leaping not only all around me in the garage, but they were leaping 3 feet off of me in all directions because my entire body is covered in gasoline. So I ran on fire back into my mom and dad's house, stood there on fire, screaming for help, praying for a hero. I'll take anybody. And I see my 9-year-old or my 17-year-old brother racing toward me. When I was hoping for a hero, Michael, this was not my ideal version of who the hero may be. And yet, this is my brother Jim's moment to change who he was into a better version of himself. I think there's something here that we could unpack for the rest of the interview if we wanted. But he changed. He ran past me, picked up a rug, began beating down the flames. The flames, like I said, leaping 3 feet off of my
Well,
body.
when you mentioned earlier the can had split, in other words, what you're really saying is I now was covered in gasoline.
Covered in gasoline, and the gasoline is immediately ignited. So yeah, I'm covered in gasoline, but it's hot, man. It's burning. It's drenched into the clothes. It is a mess. And so I can't put myself out, but my brother, through determination, because every time he swings into the flames, he himself is catching. I mean, he's burning himself. And our natural reaction as human beings is to self-preserve. It's to pull back and save yourself. I think we do this at work. We do it in relationships. We certainly do it when we are fighting fire, unless we're fighting for a cause greater than ourselves. And I think this is, I mean, if you're just trying to go be happy in life, you're going to struggle because it's really hard to stay on fire with happiness. I think our goal then ought to be surrendering to joy. And in that, gosh, we can find great peace, we can find great resilience, we can find great determination, and we can be the encouragement to those around us in our lives that they're seeking. And I think we live and work and play in a marketplace of negativity and regret. And Jim inspired me in that day to save my life, but subsequently he's remains my hero because he never changed back. He's still a great guy.
And that's it's absolutely amazing. He got beat you down with the flames. He then wrapped you in a rug, is it?
Right. I mean,
And
after moments, it's hard for me to track the exact amount of time, but after many swings, the flames were beat down enough that he could wrap me in that little blanket, carry me outside, throw me on the grass, jump on top of me, save my life. Became my hero. Not only that, but 1987, a long time ago, in a state far, far away from where you are today, Missouri, Jim O'Leary was the lifesaver of the year recipient for the state. So he was not only my hero, who is right, recognized by those who know what heroes look like to say, gosh, this guy is a living, breathing model of heroism.
And it's not just your brother, because your brother Jim was a hero that day, but if I ever name right, Sarah was also a massive hero. So I don't know where Jim got the foresight to do this and how his brain even remotely flipped the switch. And then 10 times more, I don't know how she knew how to do this. What did your sister Sarah do? What was going on with you? And
Yes.
what did you send her to do?
I know. Your poor followers today are like, man, I came for a little inspiration. And instead, I'm wiping my tears as this thing is unpacking. And I think those tears are going to continue to come. But as we go deeper down the interview, I think you're going to realize they're not tears of sorrow, but tears of great joy. And that what is true in my story is also true in all of our stories. There's reason for hope, and there's reason to celebrate joy. But what this little girl does, two sisters actually, the first one comes outside. She can see that my brother has just saved my life, but she can see me standing in the front yard naked. My clothes and skin are burnt off. She runs over to me, which is the opposite of what I naturally would do. She puts her arms around me and she pulls me close. And the first thing that this older sister says, Michael, is, John, everything's okay. Everything's fine. Have faith and fight. The best is yet to come. Which is already pretty audacious, but it's important to realize I feel so hot to her that morning that she is certain that she is burning her arms as she holds on to me in the front yard. But my sister Amy never let go. She never let go. So she just holds on. She keeps encouraging. And while she's encouraging, I'm looking over her shoulder and I see my house with flames leaping out of the roof line, which was discouraging as a child, knowing that I'm the reason why my mom and dad's house is on fire.
Yeah.
I remember looking down and I saw my hands, which are beat down, my body, my legs, my stomach, every part of it, completely disfigured, which was discouraging. And then I hear my sister say again, Amy, everything's okay. John, everything's okay. Have faith and fight. So I say back to her, Amy, knock it off. It is not okay. It's not all right. I want you to go back into the house. I don't care if it's on fire. I want you to go into the kitchen, get me a knife, come on back out here, and I want you to kill me, which is brutal. And it's, I'm assuming it better be hard for your listeners to hear because it's painful.
Well,
it's brutal.
If I pause you for a second so we can take that in, you were not joking. That's the amount of physical and emotional.
Oh,
it was a mess.
It's broken and there is no way forward. And as brutal as it was for me that day, you know, on average, 25% of Americans have dealt in mighty ways with depression. And those are people who are clinically over there. I think the remaining 75% have had their days where they think, my gosh, there is no way forward. There is no way forward. I felt that way. I've been there and I think we all have. And we've also felt the power of someone coming into the gap, coming into the darkness with us, holding us close and saying, you're wrong. Hang on. Hang on. You're a fool. Hang on. I'm going to do this thing with you. And that's what I received that day from Amy, this 11-year-old. She pulls me even closer. She speaks truth to me. You can say these words to me later on, Michael, if you want. She says to me, John, shut up. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you, man? Have faith and fight. The best is yet to come. And overhearing the conversation is the other sister, the one you referenced earlier, who is my younger sister. There is no love between the two of us because all the mean things my brother Jim does to me, I hate him for.
Rolls downhill.
But yeah, it's plumbing, man. It goes downhill. I learned from and I do to her. She goes back into the house. I'm assuming
she's
going back.
So how old is she? Or was she?
She's seven. She's seven. Goes back into the burning house, Michael, through the smoke, through the fear. We could riff on fear for quite a while here. That's really what's going on. Yeah. Toward the flames, into the kitchen. She blindly opens up the drawer, reaches in, grabs it, comes sprinting back outside. I'll never forget where I stood in the front yard with my one older sister holding me in the front yard in love, and then my younger sister racing toward me, you know, the opposite of love. She sprints toward me. There are tears coming over her big fat cheeks. Cheeks are smut covered. She stands about 2 feet away from me, and then she takes action. She throws a cup of water right into my face. Man, I want to die. And I know many of our followers, we've been there. We've all been there. It's one of our stories. Maybe not one we share, but it's one we all have endured. I want to die. And this 7-year-old sister has just gone back into a burning house for water on this childlike hope that it might inspire me or encourage me or save me somehow. And after she throws the first cup of water in my face, she runs right back in and she throws a second cup. And then she goes back in a third time, risks her life for mine. It's a miraculous story. And 3 cups of water right into my face safely, saving my life by risking hers.
It jumps way ahead. But you burned over, not over.
Yeah.
You burned 100% of your body. And the majority. Was it 87% was third degree burns?
Exactly right. 100% burned, which is a death sentence, and 87% was third degree, which means this thing is hopeless. The way they figure out, just to put it in context, burn care these days, is they take the percentage of the body burned, 100. I know some of us are like, dude, we were told there'd be no math involved. But yes, there's math involved today. 100% of the body burned. Mm-hmm. They add your age, mm-hmm. and now they've got mortality. So in 2016, there's no chance. But in 1987, this is hopeless math, man. There's just no chance forward.
But she poured water on your face, and I'm guessing it hit your scalp too.
Yeah, you know, I know where you're leading this, so... This is not just some idle little girl who did something kind for me. You see on the Skype interview right now, my face is not burned, and yet my hands are. And if I
Do you want to describe your hands? Is that okay?
Yeah, of course. My hands. I'm missing the fingers on both hands. I just have little nubs instead of fingers right now remaining. I have scars from my neck all the way to my toes, and there is no let up. I'm broken and beat down for the entire body, except this big, goofy, grinning smirk and these bright eyes, this big old thick
for everybody,
nose.
For everybody listening, if you could see him, and I highly recommend, check him out on YouTube or check him out on our YouTube channel. Face is perfect. Perfect.
Right.
Beautiful smile. Pearly whites. Looks, looks like you've never had a rough day in your life.
Right. And we've had a few, as we all have. The amazing thing is the doctors credit Susan, my little sister, she's 7, and that water and those cups of water and the repeatedly cooling of the water for saving my face and saving my scalp, which saved not only my face, which is, hey, man, I'm grateful for it. Mm-hmm. It's in some ways the best part of me physically, my face. It's still there. But she also saved my scalp, which gave me my hair, which is nice, although it's graying today. But it's also where they took layer after layer after layer after layer of skin as a donor site, mm-hmm. to cover the rest of my body. So she, in so many ways, gave me not only my face, but my life. It's an amazing story of selflessness.
If people don't know the medical, and I don't know, claim to be a great expert in it, but you need skin in order to graft skin. You need healthy skin to graft skin. And without that, there's nothing. There's nowhere to go.
So third degree burns mean, hey, it's never again coming back. It's not going to just scar. It's not going to heal. Mm-hmm. And so the way to cover up, you can't donate your skin, Michael. And you can't keep it long from a cadaver or a pig. Ultimately, you need your own skin. And for me, all of the skin for all these procedures to cover the other 87% of my body came from my scalp, which doctors credit her with saving. Amazing gift.
So going forward, you get into the hospital. Now you've got your mom there. You're looking for the milkshake promise.
Yes.
And this is why I say she's the greatest hero in the world. Jessica was saying she's enlightened. What words of what did she tell you?
Yeah. So the milkshake promise, again, just to remind people as they wipe their tears one final time. The milkshake promise is telling everybody else around us that it's going to be okay. This is primarily what politicians do when they're talking about themselves. When they're talking about others, they talk about how horrible the economy is, how horrible the other people are, how horrible policies are. But let me give you my milkshake promise. And they tell you how great they are and how beautiful things will be under their watch. That's the milkshake promise. We do it politically. We do it relationally. We do it in business. We do it in every aspect of life. And it's not healthy. It's not helpful. My mom is looking down at her dying child, and he's looking up, begging and pleading for the milkshake promise. He wants to be told that everything's going to be okay.
Yeah.
And instead, she says, baby, do you want to die? It's your choice. It's not mine. She demands that day, Michael, that I put accountability not into somebody else's court, somebody else's life, somebody else's silo, but that I actually own it myself. It's the boldest question that I think I've been asked in my entire life. And it's one of the most wild stories of true leadership that I've ever witnessed or read about.
Can you repeat that one more time for us?
Yeah. So I say, am I going to die? And her response is essentially, do you want to? Your choice. Not mine. And I look back at her, Michael, and say, Mama, I do not want to die. I want to live. And her response to me was, baby, then you look at me. You take the hand of God, you walk the journey with him, but you fight like you have never fought before. And on that day, Michael, I had no clue what the following day or the following day or the following day or that first skin graft or the bandage changes in the therapy to follow may be like. What I knew on day one, and I think, by the way, for your followers, this is enough. This is enough to know that the fight is on. The fight is on today.
It is what, if I was to label why I consider you such a hero, it is because what you did in that moment is you flipped the inner flame that said, no matter what, I'm going to fight. I don't even know what that looks like. I'm just going to fight.
Well, it's an opportunity we all have. You don't need to be part of the book. I call out very clearly, this is not a burn story, actually. This is not a hero story, actually, not in the traditional sense. This is an ordinary story of ordinary individuals showing up in profoundly important ways by flipping that inner flame in their lives. And in doing so, they show up differently, which is the first step. But the second step, the beautiful piece, is what they are then free to do in the community that is starred for it.
I love it. So I want to go forward. We're going to jump around in your story a little bit here.
Yeah, right on.
But and I'm not crediting your mom with tough love. She's all love. But when you got home, that the dinner table, the first night, and we didn't even go there. You no longer have your fingers, like you said. You had just the stubs at all. So I imagine that you weren't really prepared for feeding yourself. And what what happened? I'm laughing. I'm leading the witness. I'm so sorry.
That's awesome. So I think what's going to come very clear as we go farther down this path is my mother was a jerk who saved my life and gave me back the ability to really do something with it. So we'll unpack that here. I've been in the hospital for 5 months. Mm-hmm. I've been through pain that we won't even unpack today because it's unnecessary. It's not really part of what this story is really all about, but it was part of my story and it was brutal. And now I'm finally home. The recovery is beginning. The celebration is on. The family and friends have partied with us all day. They are now gone. It's my mom and dad and my 5 siblings in this beautifully rebuilt house. The party's on. Mom, back to the original question that kicked off our event, was making my favorite meal, which is au gratin potatoes.
Woo.
They are in front of me, that cheesy goodness, man, covered in butter. I am ready to roll. The problem is I don't have fingers to eat this. My favorite sister, noticing the problem, grabs my fork. She picks it up. She brings it toward my mouth. And right before the potatoes enter my mouth, my mother looks at my sister and says, Amy, drop that fork. If John's hungry, he'll feed himself. And Michael, I remember looking at my mom, looking at her and saying, what are you talking about? I can't do this. Mom, you're going to ruin dinner. And she refused to relent. I think that day she ruined dinner. I remember flipping over the plate. And I remember crying and being angry and mad. And she ruined it not just for me, but really for the entire dinner, for the entire family. But I also remember, Michael, by the end of dinner, I had wedged a fork between my two hands. I had scooped up some potatoes. I was looking angrily with great hate toward my mom. But the important part is this. I was feeding myself. Mm-hmm. Not my sister, not my mom, not a therapist, not anybody else. But I was able to finally feed myself. And I fed myself the following day and the following day and every day for the 21 years that have followed.
I love it. It's making me think of after my first near-death experience, and I was supposed to be in the hospital, in this rehab hospital, for months, and I wanted to go home bad. And so over the course of somewhere between 12 and 24 hours, depending on how you look at it, I was trying to teach myself how to move my legs,
right?
How to get myself in and out of a bed just to bluff my way home.
Right.
How to modify this crutch walkery thing so I could mobilize myself out of the bed, and what I was able to do the next day to bluff my way out in front of the PTs was I was able to use the bathroom myself, and that to me was the greatest experience.
It's a big deal, man.
Freedom. So the sense of freedom of being able to feed yourself, even in the midst of way pissed off with momdom.
Right on. And I think your example is perfect. Or use the restroom. Or for the listeners, hey, maybe it's, hey, I'm gonna get a job, or I'm gonna graduate. I'm gonna prove you wrong. I think that ability to get out of the bed, whatever that bed is we are laying in today, is so important. Sometimes we need to ignite it ourselves, but other times we need the kind of leader like my mother to step in and light that internal flame within us, because we may not have it yet for ourselves.
Amen. So from there, switching gears, why do you like Goodwill Hunting so much?
I'm hugely attracted to Damon and Ben Affleck. You know, that's clearly the reason I'm so into it. What about you?
He's genius. He's crazy genius.
Yeah.
Struggling genius and inner demons that he really had to work through.
Totally.
And
So I think it's one of the best movies ever done. I think Robin Williams was at his finest in that movie. And
I can still picture him where he says, "I'll put you down."
oh man, it's intense. I think he meant it too. I don't think he was acting in that moment.
Yeah.
That scene, and I know what you're going to right now again, because you're an awesome example of a guy who actually does his homework and reads material. But Robin Williams lovingly tells Matt Damon in that movie, "Hey, brother, it's not your fault. It's not your fault. It is not your fault." And Damon keeps pushing him back. "Yeah, whatever, man, whatever." But eventually, it breaks through where Matt realizes, "Wow, you know what? It's not my fault. I was born like this. I had a tough upbringing. It's not my fault. It's not my fault." Which is for him an extraordinary moment that was his inflection point that allowed him to change his entire life thereafter. In the book, though, I credit that scene, but I also challenge it. I think too frequently in an entitled society, we look back at our parents, at our upbringing, at our neighborhood, at our job site, at our workflow, at our current spouse, at whatever is going on around us, and we say, "It's not my fault. It's not my fault. It's not my fault. It's my parents. It's my brothers. It's the presidents. It's the next presidents. It's the past one. It's the federal debt. It's my spouse. It's the weather. It's the traffic. It's everybody else's fault other than mine." And there's a time and a place for that. But I don't think that's our time and place today. I think now is the time, now is the place, now is the moment to say, "You know what? It is my fault, and I'm going to do something about it. It is my life, and it is worthy. I'm going to take back the freedom of my mindset, of my thoughts, of my words, of my actions, and ultimately my results. I'm at least going to own my part of New York, or my part of Missouri, or my part of wherever I choose to listen and work and operate today." And I think that is enough to realize it is my life, and I'm going to live fully into it.
Your mom maybe is credited with helping you learn to own it. How do you help others? How do you recommend? Because it is such a, what a gear to switch, and a hard gear to switch, to go today, no matter what happened, I just lost my job. It was the worst thing that could have happened. I was the best employee and I lost my job. I did
Right.
everything for him and I lost more. How do we find the strength to take ownership?
Yeah, so first to realize that it is possible. I think the awareness around it is really critical. It is for your listeners and for you and me, Michael. I know we struggle. It is possible. Most of us live anywhere other than the moment. We are living in regrets. We are living in anxiety from what might happen tomorrow, fear on what may come in our way, struggles on what happened, chaos around yesterday or today. If you can really wake up and look out your window and see, like I do right now, cherry blossoms and
I
sunshine
got them outside here.
and breeze in your face. And then if you can get out of your place just for a little bit, walk down the street for a little bit, look at the stroller and look within the stroller and see a child, man. Look, go to the park and watch two older folks holding hands. We are so mightily blessed when we can live in the moment. So the real question is, well, how do you get into the moment, John? And I think there are three questions we ask when we are not living in the moment, and then three questions we can ask when you choose to step into it. So I'll make two quick lists with you today. The
Perfect.
first set of lists, the questions that victims love to ask when they are living either in yesterday or tomorrow, begin with a question, "Why me?" It's the victim's favorite question. Why am I so unfortunate? Why do I have such bad luck? Why did I have that horrible upbringing? And why did I lose my job yesterday when I've done everything right? Why me? Which then frees us to uncross or cross up our arms, get our heart nice and cold, and ask the great question of indifference, which is, who cares? you know, who cares, man? I'm done with it all. I'm done. I'm checking out. I'm going to play a little Candy Crush, baby. Who cares? And then the third question we will ask as our day gets worse and worse as it unfolds in front of us is, well, gosh, what more can I do? I'm just one. My life is not that great. It's a big city. It's a big state. It's a big country. It is a big world. It's a big marketplace. What more can I do? What I would challenge us to replace those three questions with, Michael, are three life-giving questions. Mm-hmm. These are the questions that breathe hope and possibility into our days, into our struggles, into our triumphs, and their choices. They're asked throughout the day, beginning with the first, and then the second, and then ending our evening with the third.
Okay.
Call these the victor's questions. The first one that she will ask every morning faithfully, without fail, is why me? Why am I so lucky? Why am I so blessed? Why can I look up my window and see cherry blossoms and see children and see older couples holding hands? Why do I still have oxygen in my lungs, man? Dang. Why do we have the freedom to do and respond and act like we choose? We live in the most righteously blessed time in the history of humankind. There is no comparison. Go by 10 years, 20 years, 100 years, 1,000 years. I don't care. Throw the dart at the board. There is never a time like we have today. Mm-hmm. And yet we spend so much time bickering about how lousy it is today that we can't even realize how fortunate it is today. Why me? Man, you didn't earn that. Why me? I'm fortunate. And today I choose to get out of bed and act like it, which will then allow us to uncross our arms as we step into a hot shower. I mean, get your hands around that one for a moment. The complexity of having hot running water in your apartment is freakish. And yet we do it every day and we take it for granted. Mm-hmm. Wow. Why me? Now, who cares if there are some struggles? It is worthy. And I choose to engage this day and every day on fire with purpose. Mm-hmm. Now, stepping through that day, living the fullness of that day, our eyes and heart open to that day, we end it by asking the third and final question. And hopefully your followers are seeing where this goes. But what more can I do to ensure that tomorrow is even better than today? What more can I do to ensure? So I journal, Michael, the mm-hmm. question, why me, in the morning, which frees me to open up my eyes and heart to the day in front of me with love and gratitude, and then ending each day with that great question, gosh, what more can I do to ensure? Don't hope for it. Hope is not a strategy. To ensure that tomorrow is even better than today.
I think that's brilliant, because what you're doing, not only are you starting the day with gratitude, and I'm journaling gratitude in the morning myself, and in the evening, I write a letter to myself to reprogram the subconscious by asking that question at the end of the evening. Mm. That's exactly what you're doing, is you're challenging yourself for further greatness overnight. I believe by you put that question there, and then the subconscious through the evening is going,
no doubt.
It's figuring out how to make your life even better.
It is working on it. You are dreaming on it. You are meditating, praying on it, and you don't even know about it. Most of us live very accidentally. The mission of my work is to wake people up from accidental living. Mm-hmm. No more excuse making, no more accidents around your thoughts, your words, your actions, or your results. Let's own it. We got one life. Let's own it and do the best we can with it.
Woohoo!
Yeah, man, fires me up.
You were a minute ago when you were talking, you had your arms crossed over you and you're kind of curled forward a little bit as you're describing things. And it reminds me of both Big Roy and the physical therapy that you had to go with, because I'm reading another book by Amy Cuddy right now, Presence, and how important body language is. And mm-hmm. you are literally curled up.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if you could share with us about that.
Sure. And specifically, because you're able to see me and some of your listeners may not be, I had my arms crossed specifically when we were going through the victim questions.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
When we go through those questions, I think we have our arms crossed physically, frequently. Take a look around. Watch on the subway. Watch as people travel through TSA. Watch them in the classroom. Watch us while we're eating dinner out. Arms crossed, life shield up. And yet great leaders, and we are they, great leaders. And I mean that to everybody listening, because we want to become a better version of ourselves. Great leaders uncross their arms. They open up their hearts. They open up their lives. And as a child, I was tied down to a hospital bed for 5 months. I can't move my arms or my legs at all.
And that was to keep you, were literally like in an X, is that right?
Yeah, exactly right. In an X, it's to keep the scars from pulling you into the fetal position. So that's my plight. That's the struggle. And Michael, into this comes a guy named Nurse Roy, who would unhook me from the bed, unhook me from the straps, unhook me from that X, get me to stand up. Even though I could not bear my own weight, he would drag me back toward the bandage change. And on the walk back, he would say to this lifeless, limp little body, this little boy, he'd say, "Boy, you are going to walk again. You might as well get used to it. Move those legs, because today you walk." And then he would say, "And I'll walk with you." And he would just drag me back, my little legs dangling between his. The first time I heard him say it, Michael, I hated him, because I knew the guy was a liar. "I'm not going to walk again, Roy. Look at my legs, man. Look at my body. It's all beat down. I'll never walk. I'm a victim to it all." And the following day, I'm laying in bed, and he walks back in. He picks me back up. He ignites that inner spark that you so eloquently spoke to earlier. Mm-hmm. And he says, "Boy, you are going to walk again. Come on, move those legs." And I think this next line is as important, Michael. "I'll walk with you. I'll walk with you, man. You're not on your own. Come on, I'll walk with you." Those visits, that walk, went on the 5 months that I was in hospital. It, in no small part, is why I am not only with you today, but why I'm able, when we hang up, to walk out of this room, walk outside, and take a lap around the block because of Roy's incredible vision for my life.
I think it also, what it makes me think beyond this is, it makes me think of what an extreme example of use it or lose it.
You know what? Right on. Creativity. Someone recently asked me at a conference, they were talking about, how do you become extraordinary, right? We want to become extraordinary individuals, extraordinary families, and extraordinary communities. That's the theme of the conference. So I was asked to speak. Someone raised their hand, and they asked, how do you become extraordinary? And I reminded them, I think you need to forget everything you've learned, because we are born extraordinary. I mean, we are born truly genius. We are sponges.
Nobody's picked up a baby. I like this. Nobody's picked up a baby and said, "Oh, just ordinary."
Yeah, this one's fine. I see a C student here. I see someone who's going to do okay things in life. We pick them up and we think, "My God, they're exceptional. They're miraculous. Look at this. Look at this genius." And then we kind of beat it out of them a little bit. And this is not critiquing our school systems. Mm-hmm. It's critiquing the way we all treat children. We get them to line up straight, arms at your side, sit there still, learn from me. I'll teach you. We learn how to become unexceptional. And I think to become exceptional, it's to unlearn many of the things we've been trained on. We should be, again, free to experience the abundance of life, man, the fullness of it, to go through our life with our eyes wide open to the grandeur and the miracle of it all. See it again through a child's eyes. And if you want to become extraordinary, that is one great way to get there.
From there, this seems extraordinary to me. What is a mission state? What is an ignition statement? And then what is your ignition statement?
Yeah, so every business, Michael, as you know, has a mission statement. Southwest Airlines, IBM, everybody's got their mission statements. Mm-hmm. They're generally plaques that we put on walls that we walk past and have no idea what they say or what they mean. But they should. They should be deeply meaningful. They should drive the individuals in the organization toward a mission bigger than themselves. So I love the idea of a mission statement when it is on fire. But I also think it needs to be delivered in the context of individual ignition statements. Mm-hmm. So the troops, the individuals, the workers can have their mission statement. And I think their mission statement should not only point toward true north for the organization, but also true north for the individual. They should light us up for our partnerships, for our marriages, for our parenting, for our responsibilities at synagogue, at church, in nature, and in life. So that's a mission statement. It is the answer ultimately to the question, why you choose to thrive. Mm-hmm. Why do you choose to thrive?
What a powerful question to ask yourself each morning.
Yeah, absolutely. It pops you out of bed. Why do you choose to get out of bed early and stay up late and uncross your arms and smile through the day and make a difference and become the best version of yourself day after day after day? Incremental change is powerful. So why do you choose to thrive? And my answer to that, my ignition statement, is because God demands it, my family deserves it, and the world is starved for it. And for me, dude and dudettes listening, that, God, man, it gets me up early. it fires me up to journal and to reflect and to pray and to meditate. It allows me to greet the rising sun with gratitude. It allows me to try at least to live my best self each day. It allows me to try to serve those around me, starting with my family, starting with my neighbors, my parents, my siblings, then stepping into strangers. I think the marketplace itself is starved for people to show up again. So that little statement, because God demands it, my family deserves it, and the world is starved for it. The world includes baristas at coffee shops. Mm-hmm. It includes TSA officers. It includes clients and prospects. It includes employees.
Woohoo! How has your dad radically inspired you?
Man, how hasn't he? So I think we're going to run out of time before I write. I really think within my story with my dad is my second book. So the first book is on fire. Mm-hmm. The second book will probably be Denny on fire. Denny is my dad. Denny is one of the greatest men I've ever met, and I'm lucky and blessed to be his son. Mm-hmm. Denny was not only a great dad to me, but today Denny has Parkinson's disease. He is immobile. He's in a wheelchair. He's lost the ability to earn. He's lost the ability to speak. He's losing the ability to swallow. He's in pain continuously. And yet, this man, my hero, Denny O'Leary, is the most grateful, passionate, on-fire human being that I've ever met. So how has he impacted me? He's impacted me profoundly by perfectly being the best version of himself today and every day before, and I'm certain every day until eventually he no longer has airs in his lung, but that great smile will continue on afterwards, I'm sure.
Beautiful. Well, we'll look forward to that second book then.
Yes.
So I want to talk about some of the amazing, miraculous people. I don't even know how these people came into your life. Maybe first you can tell us real briefly about Glenn Cunningham.
Glenn Cunningham. One of the best things about Glenn Cunningham is if you Google him, so go ahead, you will find that he was a great track star. You may find a little bit of what happened to him as a child. He was burned terribly where he grew up. He almost lost his legs. He barely kept his legs. He barely was able to walk again, barely learned to run again. And then miraculously, he becomes one of the best runners in the history of the United States track team. He fastest miler for a while, fastest of the 400 and 800, an Olympic medalist. And if that's what you look at for Wikipedia, that's all you find. But we look a little past Wikipedia. Mm-hmm. And what I found was one of the great heroes of our time. This is a man who went on, married, had a few children, and then one of the members in his community said, this child of ours is more than we can handle. Will you help raise him? So Glenn says yes. A judge in the community where he lived had a child who was between homes and asked Glenn and his wife, Ruth, if they could help raise him. So they said yes. They said yes again and again and again. And every time they said yes, the only rule for these children was that they would have to become part of the family. Which means, hey, we get to love you, but you're going to hold up your end of the bargain. You're going to do chores. You're going to hold up. You're going to take out the trash. You're going to listen to us as your parents today. In the course of saying yes to all of these kids, I believe the number is, and I don't have it in front of me, they said yes to helping raise, either for a day or for decades, more than 9,000 children. 9,000 children came into the lives of wow. Ruth and Glenn Cunningham. They opened up their life, sometimes for a day, not long, sometimes for decades to these children. They loved them. They never expected anything in return. And I was one of these children. I never came onto the ranch. But when I was a little boy, struggling after being released from the hospital, Glenn Cunningham is one of the great people who showed up in my life. He pulled up in a red truck in my driveway. I could barely stand. And he guided me through the story as we kind of just gently walked around the block. Glenn in his mid-80s, me, I'm 9 years old. We walked around. He took my arm. He just kind of walked me. And he said, John, I've got my story too. I've been where you are. And he told a story of when he was burned. He told the story of losing his brother in the fire. He told the story of learning how to slowly walk around on the fence on this ranch that he grew up on. And then eventually letting go of that fence. And then eventually jogging. Then eventually running. Then eventually sprinting. And as a 9-year-old hearing this guy who'd been where I was, a track star, an old man today, married with children, man, it was so inspiring. I'll never forget it. And I'll also never forget that just a week later, my phone rang, my mom and dad answered, And we learned that this great miracle worker, this great mile runner, this great man had died. He died of old age at home with his wife and children around him. And one of the last kids that he took into his life was a child named John O'Leary that he had never met before, but that he served beautifully. And man, here we are 3 decades later. Glenn Cunningham remains one of my great heroes in life.
It really there is so much more going on to this world than we can possibly see the strings to be pulled just right for that to have taken place.
I had an editor through this process. Mm-hmm. And we don't need to go into names or locations, but just to know this, the editor was a fairly proud atheist, and that's okay. I think everybody's right to have their beliefs. And she read this book. She remembers reading it on the subway home from work. Mm-hmm. She went 7 stations past her house. She was so engrossed with the book. She came back. She stayed up till 2 a.m. that day finishing the book. And at the end of it, she shut it, went to bed exhausted, called me first thing in the morning. And she said, John, at age 7, I lost my father. Ever since then, I have refused to believe that miracles happen. And yet after reading On Fire, it is impossible for me to imagine that miracles aren't happening and they're not happening all around me, but I've just not had eyes to see it. And so I'm not making for our listeners right now a faith argument. If we want to talk about that later on, I'm thrilled to go there. But I encourage your listeners, atheist or not, to have their eyes open for the truth that miracles are continuously around us in our lives, but we have to have eyes and hearts to see them. And then we need to be bold enough to play those miracles forward for those in the community hungry for them.
I love it. And I love the segue of saying the word play. Tell us about Jack Buck. Mm.
Jack Buck was a radio announcer for St. Louis. He's the Cardinal announcer and also the Blues announcer. And a Hall of Fame announcer. So many of your listeners, if they're past the age of 40 or so, would recognize the name Jack Buck. He's a Hall of Fame announcer who broadcast the World Series and the Super Bowl and many other games like that. Yeah, just an incredible man. I never met him, but he was my hero as a child because he's the voice of the Cardinals. That's my team growing up. I get burned on a Saturday and Sunday afternoon, Michael, I'm to hide down to the bed. I cannot move. Can't see because my eyes are swollen shut, and I cannot speak because I have a trachea. So I'm
Which
9.
Which means they literally cut open your throat, put a tube in it.
That's right, intubated. So you have a tube, you have oxygen in your lungs, but you have no ability to speak. So I'm tied down. Today, when you're burned badly, they actually put you into a medically induced coma. Back then, they gave you morphine and wished you well. And so I am awake, I'm aware, I'm sad and broken. I'm a victim to my circumstances. It's not my fault. It's not my fault. Robin Williams is constantly barking this in my ear. John, it's not your fault. And by the way, there are times where we need to hear that reminder. But I'm a victim to it all, and I'm laying there on the edge of death, falling forward, and the door opens up. And I hear footsteps first, Michael, then I hear a chair, and then I hear a cough. It's only been 36 hours since the explosion, and then I hear the voice of my childhood hero, Jack Buck, bring light into the darkness, and what he says to me is, kid, wake up. You are going to live. You are going to survive. Keep fighting. When you get out of here, we are going to celebrate. We'll call it John O'Leary Day at the ballpark. Keep fighting. And then he stands up, he walks out, he leaves me tied down in darkness by myself, Michael.
Are you going, did that really happen?
Oh my gosh, man. I'm like, dude, these drugs are awesome. That was a wild dream. Yeah, I'm thinking, did it really happen? Because it blew my mind. But I knew in my heart of hearts, it really did. Mm-hmm. And I learned later on that he found out from the staff that there was no chance. There is no chance this little boy is going to die or survive. He is going to die. He takes it home. He cries, prays, reflects, meditates, and journals on this important question that you and I talked about earlier. What more can I do? You know, I believe in stealing shamelessly from those around me. So anything you're hearing from me is not mine. Ultimately, it's borrowed from the best. Jack Buck's question, what more can I do, mm-hmm. is so powerful. It led him to a Hall of Fame career. Hall of Fame life, but it also led him to making a Hall of Fame impact on a little boy he'd not met, a little boy with no chance. Because the following day, I'm laying in darkness, my door opens up, I hear footsteps, and I get emotional even thinking about it. The chair gets dragged across the floor, and then I hear this voice,
again into the darkness. Kid, wake up. You are going to live. You are going to survive, man. I am back. And that's right. He did say that. I'm back. Keep fighting. John O'Leary Day at the ballpark will make it all worthwhile. The amazing thing, Michael, is he kept those visits going for 5 months. Never relented. Never let go.
Wow. And then from there, it sounds like he got a little of your mom's spirit going when you got out. And I'm not sure how the exact timeline works here, but you ended up getting one ball from him.
Right. So there's some amazing things that happened in between that one ball and the next ball.
And you did get John O'Leary Day, right?
Yeah, John O'Leary Day at the ballpark, which was awesome. Jack learned then, Michael, that I could not write. And to make the story very short, because I know we're going to run out of time, he sent me a baseball the following day. This is after asking the question, what more can I do? Mm-hmm. Please write that down at home or work, or if you're driving, pull over. What more can I do? It's an awesome nightly ritual. It will transform your life and the life of those lucky enough to be next to you. What more can I do? So he sends me a baseball signed by a Cardinal great named Ozzie Smith. Below that ball was a note from Jack Buck, that red kid. If you want a second baseball, all you have to do is sign a thank you letter to the man who sent the first. And the problem was, Michael, I cannot write. Mm-hmm. I can't hold a pen. I can't make it legible. He knew this, but he also knew the power of why, the power of motivation, the power of inspiration. It's no joke. I remember asking my mom to come over to me. She did. She took the lid off a pen, helped me hold it between my two hands, and I wrote this awkward note to Ozzie Smith, mailed it off. 2 days later, I got a second baseball with a second note that said, kid, if you want a third baseball. You see where this is going, Michael. By the end of 1987, a little boy in a wheelchair named John O'Leary sent 60 thank you letters in response to 60 baseballs received. Literally changed my life. I'll never forget it. The balls remain in my house. They remain, by the way, in the room of my oldest child. His name, by the way, is Jack. Perfect. So Jack has these balls that the great Jack Buck sent me, and Jack Buck's not done. When I graduated college, he shows up with a package and a note. The first word, kid, this means a lot to me. I hope it means a lot to you too. And below the note was a gift from Jack Buck. Within it, this baseball, the crystal baseball that he had received.
This is mind-blowing.
It is mind-blowing, man. When he goes into the Hall of Fame. So if you are the best at what you do in baseball or any sport, you get one trophy. That's your hardware, man. That's your gift. That's your heirloom prize to your children. And Jack Buck gives his decades later to a 22-year-old college drunk kid named John O'Leary, who can only awkwardly look up and say, wow, thanks. I mean, he doesn't know I'm going to become an author. He doesn't know I'm going to embrace the story and start sharing it. All he knows is that one person through generosity by showing up can make a profound difference. And that's what he does. He did it in my life, but he did it in countless other lives, big and small. I think the mistake we can make when we hear stories like this is to think, well, dang, I don't even have one of those balls, so I won't waste my time with the Jack Buck story. You don't need a crystal ball to make a profound impact on someone else. It can be as simple as covering the coffee for the guy in line behind you today. That's big. Holding the door open, smiling and saying, hey, good morning, and letting the person go in first. Greeting people with smiles and love and asking, hi, how's your day going? Showing up at an old friend's house that you haven't seen in a while with two sandwiches and saying, hey, let's do lunch together, my treat. Little things can make a profound impact. Writing the thank you letter, little things. So I encourage your leaders, your followers, to ask that simple question and to see what happens through their life.
Beautiful. So two more things I want to cover, and then we got to do some quick wrap-up questions. First off, I talked about it, alluded to it briefly at the beginning, Gino Cavallini and fighting on your behalf, brawling on your behalf.
It's brawl, baby. So really the condensed version, we're sucking all energy out of this thing, but we are going to do it anyway. I'm burnt. I'm laying in bed. I'm on my stomach. I've been there for 3 weeks. I'm discouraged. Gino walks in. He's a hockey player. He's busy. He's 26. He's visiting kids in the hospital. He becomes my friend, and he sees that my spirits are down. And so he tells me that night, hey, superstar, tonight I'm going to do something cool for you. I'm going to score you a goal. And so I say back to Gino, Gino, do us both a favor, man. Get in a fight instead. Because Michael, Gino's a tough guy. He's not a goal scorer. And so this wonderful Canadian-born kid looks back up and says, all right, superstar, if I can't score a goal, I promise you I'll get in a fight.
And, so and as a night, kid, as a boy, this is like
– this is first rate. To be visited by a pro athlete, that alone, it's – hey, dude, game's on. But to have him come back and come back and then to make commitments and then to tell me he'll get in a fight blew me away. And then in the first period of the game, when the dude actually got in a fight while we're listening on the radio, my mom and dad and I are laughing about it. Here's this tough 26-year-old kid brawling. And if it ended there, I think, hey, dude, what a cool story. But the beautiful thing is it's not done. In the third period with the score tied 2-2, Gino Cavallini, this guy who never scores goals, kept the original promise, scored the game winner, started crying on the ice. The hockey players on the ice congratulated him, and they started crying. And then that night, Michael, they all went out and partied. They got hammered that night at a burn center with soda, pizza, and a 9-year-old little boy named John O'Leary that none of them had met before.
Oh my God.
Stayed till 2:30 in the morning. The party raged. That night, I think we collectively as a community celebrated a gift that was more worthy than a scoreboard. And I think that's the lesson from this cool story, that it's not about the score. Mm-hmm. It's not about paychecks. It's about living into commitments and mission and making a difference for others. And in that, scoreboard eventually will show it. Eventually, paycheck will represent it. I think too frequently in life, we pursue the wrong thing. If we pursue significance and we pursue love and we pursue showing up, these other things that are more easy to track will begin to build behind us.
I love it. So just one more story we want to cover, and then we'll do a few quick rapid questions. And I don't think we're squeezing all the juice out of this because we haven't shared. It's one thing to say you've healed from a fire. It's another thing to project 30 years forward to what you're doing now. And that's in the book as well. And we haven't touched on that at all, which is an amazing story in and of itself. And that's the transformation that I think everyone needs to get your book and learn about, because that is, you have been living life on fire. So with that said, how in the world did you meet Beth?
Yeah, so the even a different way to frame is, how in the world did a girl that hot say yes to you? I mean, let's just call it up.
The words in my head that are going on are little sis, a hot little sis.
Dude, so for those who are listening and haven't seen pictures online or in the book yet, I married a girl named Elizabeth Grace. She is stunningly attractive. She's got brown hair, brown eyes, beautiful angel face. But when I talk about attractive, I'm talking about her heart. She just is a beautiful, beautiful lady inside and out. I met her in college. I pursued her relentlessly. I would ask her out repeatedly, and her response was always, John, no, you are like a brother to me. You are like a brother to me. And this goes on again and again and again. And I think to do the story justice, honestly, people are just going to have to read about it, because the turning point in our story was this. I stopped pursuing her for my interest. Mm-hmm. I stopped trying to get a girlfriend. I stopped trying to have arm candy. I stopped trying to do things that boys do with girls, man. You know, I stopped trying to eventually get married. And instead, I pursued serving this gal for what she wanted, which was a friend, which was a buddy, which was a date occasionally to movies and dinner. And I just started loving her for who she was. And in that transition, in that shift, everything changed. My mindset, my words, my heart. And this is the cool thing, Michael. Eventually, her mindset, her words, her heart. We were at dinner after going to a movie. This is what friends would do. And halfway through dinner, she leans over and says, John, every time I'm with you, I get butterflies. I think I'm falling for you. And then she says, John, will you date me? And of course, my answer was yes. You know, we dated for 3 years. We've been married for over 12. Marriage is not easy. Dating's not easy. Partnerships are not easy. Parenting's not easy. Life is not easy, but it's worth it. And it's certainly part of our why. We are convicted behind it, and we're doing the absolute best to make today better than yesterday and striving to make tomorrow even better than today.
Beautiful. So what words of wisdom would you have for parents with kids coming from, you've had a very unique 30 some odd years?
Yeah. So I would remind them that I had a unique 30 somewhat years, but mom and dad have five other kids to raise. And that same tough love has served all six of us in very effective ways. We are professionally all doing great. We are relationally all doing great. We spiritually are very alive. My mom and dad were not easy parents. And let's be clear, they weren't perfect parents. Mm-hmm. They dropped the ball. They made mistakes. They yelled. They freaked out. They did the dumb things that all parents do. But they huddled up. They learned. And they did life better afterwards. They were great examples to us. And they reminded us that this is our life. You have one opportunity at it. And it is their expectation and should be ours that we live fully into it.
Beautiful. So where can people go to find out more and to find your book?
Yeah, so the book is called, like you're showing, they're right there, On Fire. I think the amazing thing about the book is to understand that 8 years ago, I'd never told anybody how I was burned and that I don't consider myself a presenter or a speaker. And until just months ago, not even a writer. Simon & Schuster called and asked if I would be willing to write about my book, about our story. And I said, yes. Spent 3 to 4 years reflecting, journaling, really getting this thing right. You said, John, gosh, clearly someone has – you put a lot of time into this, and we put a lot of focus onto it. We wanted it to be just right, and I did not want it to be an autobiography. I wanted it to be highly inspiring mirror to encourage and inspire people to wake up from accidental living so that they, too, can do life even better today than they did yesterday.
I have to pause you, even though we're running really short on time. I got to pause you. If you took 3 to 4 years of introspection on this – there must have been some some inner demons, some things waiting in the closet that you had to work past. What was one of the toughest things you had to work past to get through this book?
And the inner demon's the number one. That voice in your head that echoes loudly. You're not worthy. No one's going to read it. Simon Schuster's going to reject it. The editor's going to say it's crap. They're going to throw it away. And even if they, for some reason, print it, who's going to read it besides your mom and your family? All that stuff. And so the biggest inner demon for me is to realize, hey, dude, it is worthy. The community is starved for hope and inspiration, starved for that next clear next step. They will be desiring this thing in a mighty way as long as it's not about ego, John, as long as it's not about paycheck, as long as it's not about your notoriety, as long as it's about the reader, they will soak it up. And the beautiful thing about that is – it came out on March 15th. It debuted on Amazon at number 8. It went up to number 1. It's already considered a national bestseller. It's been considered such by LA and Wall Street and all these other big publications. That's not me. That's not I. That's not my mom or my dad or Roy or Jack Buck. That's a story about we and what's happening when we fully invest in those around us by first investing fully in ourselves.
Woohoo!
And dude, turns me on. It lights me up because I think the movement is afoot, and this negativity that is so commonplace in media and in debates is beginning to slowly shift. So let's hang on and let's lead that shift together.
And I highly recommend, I'm thumping on it here for those who can't see it, I highly recommend this book because it will leave you on fire. Did you have a website for people to go to?
Yeah, so probably the best place to get the book is that most book retailers, you know, they are all carrying it right now, and Amazon, of course, online. If you're looking for me and you want to stay in touch, I would love it. I love having conversations with people online after great shows like this. So my website is John, J-O-H-N, O-Leary, O-L-E-A-R-Y, Inspires, I-N-S-P-I-R-E-S. John O'Leary inspires.com. Mm-hmm. Or if you Google John O'Leary, it will be hard to miss that website. And let's just stay in touch there. I'm looking forward to doing life together.
Beautiful. And if you don't remember John O'Leary, just come over to our website. We got all the links. We'll get you over there. I've got one or kind of one and a half wrap-up questions for you.
Yes.
Which is, I guess we'll call it a two-parter. If you had it to do all over again, would you? And then
great.
Final words of wisdom.
Yeah, well, let's put them together. So it's a beautiful question, and it's one I've been asked a couple times. It's easy to look back and say, gosh, why would you do that again when you lost your fingers, when you have no normal skin from your neck to your toes, and just between a few of us listening right now, I'm in pain all the time, physically. And life would be a lot easier if I was not burned. So the answer seems to be, dude, of course I would not blow myself up again. Until you say, well, gosh, did any good come out of it? And then you realize, yeah, you know what? It did change my brother Jim's life. And my two little sisters showed up in ways they would have never shown up and have remained changed subsequently. I think that's a big part of what happens in our childhood. It shapes us into the adults we become. So they changed. They have remained. So my mom and dad were good parents. They became extraordinary parents through the fire. The community that had never been tested showed up. They gave us houses. They gave us money. They gave us blood. They gave us food. They gave us clothes. They showed up in a mighty way, and they would not have shown up otherwise. A little boy who had never done anything worthy in his life had to own his life and then own the next step and then choose where he went to school, which led to where he met his bride, which led to four little kids, which led to you, Michael, and I doing this interview together today, which led to 1,500 talks in the last 7 years. It's led to thousands and thousands and thousands of copies of the book On Fire being sold, touching other people's lives, inspiring them that their best days are in front of them. All of that because of a horrible fire. So yes, I would do it again. And to answer the second question, my hope is, as your listeners are tuning in right now, that they realize from their tragedies, from their fire, from their horrible upbringing, from the mistakes of yesterday, that it has led to and will lead to the best of their story going forward.
Woohoo! Thank you so much, John. Yes.
I'm sorry, I get fired up, man. This isn't premeditated. This is not scripted. It is an energy. It's emotion. I'm fired up for my life, but I'm fired up for your life, Michael, and I'm fired up for the lives of those tuning in right now.
I believe it. I certainly do.
Thank you, man. I'm just grateful for your time and for your friends who are listening right now. I've been interviewed hundreds of times, and it's always scripted. And then I come onto a show like Michael Sandler, and he just is coming from the heart, and he can, not only because he has a beautiful heart, but because he does his homework and he cares. So, Michael, I'm grateful to be on your show. You did a phenomenal job, and woohoo! I'm lit up, man. I'm on fire, and I thank you for your time today.
Thank you. Thank you. They're in the words. This is where the announcer loses his words. But thank you so much, John. This is been awesome. Everyone, I can't recommend the book enough. And John, you are on fire. You were given a special gift. And so we're lucky for every day that we have you here for,
man,
for what you're
saying
doing.
That. And in truth, I know tomorrow's not promised. When you survive the unsurvivable and you deal with the likelihood of death always around the corner, truly. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't take days for granted, and I don't take remarks like that for granted either, Michael. So thank you for the time. Thank you for your great work. You are touching lives, and listeners, followers, so are you. So God bless. Continue boldly. The best is yet to come.
Woohoo! Thank you so much. Well, for everyone out there, this is Michael Sandler saying, be well, have fun, get on fire, and ignite your own life, and shine bright. Woohoo!
Woohoo, man. Awesome job.
Hey, everyone. Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe, see the website. Thanks so much and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!